with the exciting news that Doug Liman has signed on to direct Justice League Dark, I got a lot of requests from you guys to cast the film. However, it's too early to do that because we don't even know the lineup of the movie. I mean, Guillermo del Toro floated out a lineup, but it seems, you know, there's conflicting reports as to whether or not he's even still involved with the project. So because I'm not quite sure who I'm casting, I decided instead to make a list of the top five ideas for Justice League Dark. Because I have to say, I think it's going to be a perilous endeavor. And I'm glad that Doug Liman is at the helm, because it's going to require an amazing amount of discipline. Something that the DCEU has been lacking. I think if you really want to boil it down, discipline might be the answer to all their problems. But we'll see. They're heavily encouraged by their box office results. But anyway, let's get started. And I think you'll be surprised that my first suggestion or top idea for Justice League Dark illustrates what a risky move it is, and that I'm not even sure if I would make the movie. So what's the number one thing? Don't rip off Suicide Squad, because I'm pretty sure that that's one of the reasons that they're pushing forward so aggressively with this film. I'm sure when they got Doug Liman in a room, they were like, how'd you like your own Suicide Squad type movie? Do you see all the attention it's getting? Do you see how many people know who David Ayer is? That could be you. But, you know, people are saying mixed things about David Ayer, and that could also be Doug Liman. Also, I have to say, I don't know how many teams the DCEU can support, right? Because the comics certainly couldn't. Justice League Dark isn't even published anymore. The comic was canceled. It did run for about 4 years, to its credit, but it did not last. Justice League of America, remember that experiment? Also no longer around. And so I think it's weird to greenlight a movie on a comic book that was canceled and also features a main character whose movie didn't work out and whose TV show was canceled. But hey, we'll see. I do think that there's potential here. But again, as I said, it's a treacherous path to get to a successful adaptation of those good ideas. But anyway, if I were running the DCEU, I would focus on the Justice League and the Suicide Squad. Those would be my light and dark teams. Everybody already loves them, and I think that both of those teams need a lot of focus. But instead, they're going to expand the kind of teams that they have, which is something that happened in the comics, again, with the New 52. They even had a big event which featured a character called Pandora. Remember that? No, not many people do. But they had the Justice League and the Justice League of America and the Justice League Dark all interacting with each other. And there was actually a big like poster spread to get everyone excited about it. And that's really all I know, because I dropped the crossover story partway through because it didn't make any sense. But anyway, I think that you could do Justice League Dark without being a ripoff of Suicide Squad, but you have to do a couple of things to avoid that. One is you have to, these are like subcategories of my number one idea. You have to have a strong main character, which I believe will and should be John Constantine. And I also, you know, instead of having like the group focus they did in Suicide Squad, we'll get to that in a moment. But also I would go with a highbrow horror approach instead of the colorful, raunchy fun fest that is Suicide Squad. And you need a director that can tell the difference, and because I think that the pull will be to go in the Suicide Squad direction because there's such fan support for that, and it did succeed at the box office, and it's just fun, right? I mean, those visuals are so fun. Why not be like, let's do the magic version of that? But that would be Enchantress, right? And that character, I think, turned out to be one of the weakest in Suicide Squad. So that's my number one suggestion. Number two, John Constantine and Zatanna are your stars. Suicide Squad had too many stars and surprise fan favorites, and that resulted in a lack of focus, not just story-wise, where you're like, who's the lead character? And it's like, ha, trick question, there is no lead character. But also from a business standpoint, they didn't know who to advertise. They're like, oh, it's Will Smith's movie. Oh, it's Margot Robbie's movie. Oh, it's Jared Leto's movie. Surprise, another trick, he's not even in the movie. So I think that they should know from the get-go that this is the John Constantine and Zatanna movie, cast heavyweights in those roles, write the script to support that, and then with the other members of the Justice League Dark team, or Dark Universe, whatever they're calling it, I would actually go with Dark Universe because I think it clarifies or tries to make it clear that this is something different. but have very strong supporting actors playing the other members of the team and their roles written as supporting. I think that's crucial. Now, there's a very strong rumor that Colin Farrell is John Constantine, and I wasn't sure about this, but the more I looked into it, the more I believe that it's probably true if Colin Farrell is indeed in Justice League, as again has been rumored. Why? Well, the whole reason that John Constantine was created, Alan Moore said, was that, well, he said his directive was to create a character that looked like Sting, which Colin Farrell does not. But anyway, he said he thought it would be interesting to do a blue-collar warlock, because warlocks are usually gentlemen, right? So he thought, wouldn't it be fun to run in the opposite direction? And I'm a big fan of running in the opposite direction, which I guess is one of the reasons I like Alan Moore's work so much, so I think this is great. And I think if you said to me, who should we cast as a blue-collar warlock, I would think Colin Farrell would be a pretty awesome idea from a creative standpoint. Business-wise, there are serious problems with it. But before we move to that discussion, I'd like to point out that Colin Farrell, of course, has a very large role in the upcoming Fantastic Beasts supposed trilogy. I'm saying supposed because we don't know how Fantastic Beasts is going to perform at the box office. It could not do well, partially because of Colin Farrell. He has a very strong track record of being box office poison. But Ezra Miller is also in Fantastic Beasts, and Warner Brothers is the kind of company that likes to have company men and women, Ben Affleck being one of those people, for instance, Zack Snyder being one of those people, which is why he got the DC gig in the first place. You know, he had competition, but he was the only in-house guy. So it looks like Warner Brothers wants to get into the Colin Farrell business. But I don't know if anyone should get into the Colin Farrell business, because again, if you look at his box office, I think the audience has largely rejected him. And I think the reason he continues to get work is because I've interviewed Colin Farrell on the green carpet for Epic a couple of years ago, and he is just an absolute prince of a guy. He is so incredibly charming. You're like, Colin Farrell, I would want to be in the Colin Farrell business after talking to him for just a few minutes. But then I would need someone, you know, reliable working with me or for me who would snap me out of it and say, look at his box office numbers, Grace. And I'd be like, I'm so sorry, Colin Farrell. I love you still so much, but I don't think anybody else does. We'll see. Maybe they can somehow get across how awesome he is to the general movie-going public, but so far no one has been able to do that. Maybe you should get a reality show. All right, so my third idea, and this is going to be controversial, boy, and that is when they race bend Zatanna, do it very, very carefully. And some of you might be already like to your keyboards being like, race bend Zatanna, what are you talking about? Madness. But there was a rumor they were going to do it before, and I think they are. I can feel it in my bones. She's a prime candidate for race bending. I think particularly because she is a little bit like Harley Quinn. She's going to be the Harley Quinn of this movie, basically. And they already have a white Harley Quinn. So why not create, a different ethnicity variation on that and spread out your demographic net? It makes very strong sense from a business perspective. And if they get it right, they could pull it off. But it's going to be very tricky to do it. Also, movies that have diversity in them do very well at the box office. Suicide Squad, one of its strengths is that it has a diverse cast. Now, many people have said, well, what about the new Black Orchid, Alba Garcia? She's diverse, but it's not a big enough role, and I don't think it's a flashy enough role to really be what Warner Brothers wants. And what Warner Brothers needs! Now, Will Smith was Deadshot, and that's an example of race bending of a character that worked, but not really worked, because nobody rejected him. He has his fans. The movie did well. But at the same time, no one's like, oh, I love Will Smith's Deadshot. He's amazing, right? And he even had my favorite scene in the movie, but he just really hasn't caught on. So you need to cast someone who's going to get people as excited as Margot Robbie when she was cast as Harley Quinn. It needs to be that much of a lightning bolt, I guess you could say. Now, I would actually recommend Penelope Cruz. I think she's a very good match with Colin Farrell, but she might be older than Warner Brothers wants to go, which would be a shame because, again, I think she would be absolutely fantastic. But another person I might consider is Ana de Armas from War Dogs, who's actually upcoming Blade Runner 2, which, as many of you recently pointed out, is a Warner Brothers movie, and Jared Leto has gone over to that film. So why not take her over into Suicide Squad? I thought she was very appealing in War Dogs. I saw a lot of potential there. So she could potentially be a great Zatanna. So we'll see. But it's going to be difficult for them to pull that off. But if they do it, if they really are careful and take it seriously, I think that it could work. Now, also for Zatanna, she's the focus of my number four, and that's use the Zatanna mind wipe. I mean, they already took Wonder Woman's controversial move, the neck snap, and gave it to Superman. So let Zatanna keep hers. And again, this is very controversial. I'm sure a lot of people would like to see that mind wipe storyline be mind wiped away, right? Where that came from was Identity Crisis. That was a crossover big event story a couple of years ago. A big novelist writer came in and there DC was like, work your novelist magic. And, you know, everyone was like, I don't really want this in my comics. It doesn't work. I mean, it's not one of those famous stories. I think because it got a little too real. It focuses around the rape of elongated man's wife, Sue Dibney, and Dr. Light's mind being wiped as a result. The Justice League takes a vote, and they're like, let's wipe his mind so that he doesn't do this again, right? Let's change criminals' behavior. And Zatanna is the one who did it. Now, in the storyline, Batman, now, if you would like to read Identity Crisis yourself and have these mysteries unfold before your eyes, skip ahead to number 5, but, you know, otherwise, feel free to stick around. I'll explain it to you. So what happens is that Zatanna is like, okay, I'll do it. We voted. I'm going to wipe his mind. So as she's in the process of wiping Dr. Light's mind or adjusting his personality, Batman comes in and he's like, what are you doing? And everyone's like, stop him. So Zatanna freezes him. Justice League takes another vote and decides to wipe Batman's mind of the moment because they don't want to have to be lectured by him constantly or have him potentially tell Dr. Light about it. So Batman understandably eventually finds out and is very angry. It's also revealed that Catwoman, who became kind of more of a hero than a villain in the comics, they decided to explain that away by saying that Zatanna is the one who made her decide to do that, to be more of a hero. And then she got really angry about it, went back to being more villainous. And a lot of problems with the mind wipe element that was introduced into the storylines. But I think it's good. It gets people talking. It creates tension, drama, and it takes magic beyond just like magic tricks. Magic tricks are awesome. We'll talk about that. That's number 5. But it adds a psychological element to it, not only in terms of, you know, making it more complex, but also, you know, arguments to be had. What's the ethical question of magic, which I think is great. I think that would be really nice and add a layer of sophistication to Justice League Dark, or again Dark Universe, that Suicide Squad doesn't have. It would be another way to separate them. Then finally, my number 5 suggestion for Justice League Dark is use magic, please. Marvel's Doctor Strange has decided to really focus strongly on alternative realities, and magic is martial arts, and as a result, they've kind of presented this diluted version of magic, which really doesn't seem quite like magic at all, except for a few light tricks, right? Now, I want to see Justice League Dark go full magic. And, you know, we've had Harry Potter be very successful. Warcraft, excellent use of magic, but not enough. Not as much as I would have liked to have seen. And Sci-Fi's The Magicians has a pretty good use of magic. I tried to watch that show, couldn't really get into it, but I was impressed with their use of magic. So I would love, we haven't seen any property, though, go full magic. And I would really love to see that be the calling card for Justice League Dark and what sets it apart from all the other big movies. I mean, magic can be really amazing. It can amp up your action sequences. I mean, they should really treat it like a mutant power, right? Like, isn't it great when, especially when they've done a good job of getting the mutants finally a VFX improve, of using mutant powers really excitingly in action sequences to turn them up to an 11, right? So just think of Justice League Dark as a team of mutants where they just all have magic power, like they all have the same mutant power, and that's ability to use magic. Although there are a couple members of the team that have, you know, different powers that are really kind of a little bit like mutants, but, you know, all the teams are a little bit like X-Men teams that's where this starts to get a little bit muddled, and where these directors and writers and producers have to be really careful to make sure that they differentiate them. Because there's the thing, at the end of the day, comic book fans can take it because we're used to it. We read comics all the time. We're good at compartmentalizing and being like, well, this team's different because of that, and this team exists over in this universe, et cetera, et cetera. But when you take your average moviegoer, and the average moviegoer only goes to the movies once a month, if that, they're not used to this. It just all starts to seem like the same. And so that's something also that if they want to keep this comic book renaissance going in Hollywood, they have to do the hard work of, you know, bringing in the mainstream moviegoer into this kind of mentality. I know it's not fun, you know, but you have to lay the groundwork if you want to, you know, lay the track if you want that train to keep going. So that's my thoughts on Justice League Dark. I'm very nervous about it, but also very excited, and I'd be curious to hear your thoughts about the movie as well down below. All right, thanks for watching, and you can check out some more coverage right now.